Let's welcome back to Midpoint retired U.S. Army three-star Lieutenant General Daniel Bolger. Lieutenant General, let's get down to strategy again here right now, because we continue to talk about this. If there is going to be a change here, is there going to be a change? Is there any hope whatsoever that you have that we actually have a strategy, or is this for the president just another dodge to take up time and keep America from seeing a real thinking process on defeating an enemy?
No, I think we've got a strategy, Ed. It's not one that's going to make people happy because it doesn't promise an immediate response. Our great U.S. military, the men and women in our military, are trained for rapid, decisive operations, a desert storm, if you will. And what we're doing right now is we're supporting the Iraqis as they carry out a counterinsurgency, which is more like a Vietnam situation. It's going to last a long time. It's going to be messy. But the smart thing we've done this time compared to what we did from 03 to 11 is we're not trying to run it ourselves. We're going to let them take the lead. We're going to back them up. They'll take forever to do it, and it won't be done to our standards. But the important thing is it'll keep ISIS busy over there so they don't have time to organize terrorist training camps and threaten the United States. They'd love to do that, but when they're on the run from the Iraqis and from our Air Force, they're not going to be able to.
Building on what you just said here, has this president, Barack Obama, learned that the American military is not suited to just being a bunch of caretakers and teachers, which it seems as if they've been turned into? Is he actually going to understand that?
I do think he does. I know certainly the senior military folks do, and I'd count myself, although I'm out of the service now, as one of them. That's a hard lesson learned over the last more than 10 years of fighting since 9/11. To quote former Secretary of State Condoleezza Rice, we don't need U.S. Marines walking children to school. That's not our job. Our job is to go in, kick the door down, knock out the enemy forces, and get out of there.
Then let's go ahead and build on that as well, because Chuck Hagel was very adamant. He wanted the focus to be on Bashar al-Assad and the Syrian regime. So if we're going to go in and kick down some doors, I mean, let's just take this to the next level here. Is that the door that we've got to kick down, or we're fooling ourselves if we do anything else?
Well, there's no doubt we could do it. I think the one question we got to ask hard, and I know Secretary Hagel certainly raised this issue. I don't know with the president because I wasn't privy to those discussions, but he definitely mentioned it in public. We can destroy the Bashar al-Assad regime tomorrow. I mean, our military is more than capable of that. But we have to then look at what comes next. Are we willing to live with that vacuum? We certainly, I don't think, are going to back into this, as you pointed out, another nation-building drill. We know that that is a non-starter. So we got to think really, really hard before we kick the door down. I think, as we've seen in Iraq and Afghanistan, knocking out a hostile government is one thing, but what comes next is really the challenge.
Do we need to, as a nation then, and maybe even as an administration, finally say to ourselves at one point, we are the cops of the world, we've just got to go ahead and understand that, nobody else is going to do it, and we have to stop listening to the rest of the world. We know we're going to make some enemies, we know we're going to tick some people off down the line, but if we don't do it, nobody will, and the entire world is going to be worse for the wear if we don't do it. I know that's a huge statement, and a lot of people will find a lot of errors in there and a lot of holes, but is that maybe where we've got to at least start if we're going to beat the enemy?
We got to have that discussion, Ed. I mean, we are the world's superpower. Nobody else can match us in a military or economic sense. And the other thing I will tell you, no matter what else we hear and all this hand-wringing, in a country like Iraq, Afghanistan, or Syria, those people that are in desperate need, like the Yazidi people up on Mount Sinjar, they're scanning the horizon for the arrival of American Marines or U.S. Air Force or U.S. Army or U.S. Navy. They're not waiting for the Chinese or Russians. Nobody spends time hoping they'll come and save them.
Is there anybody that comes to mind that would be the best choice as the new Secretary of Defense in your estimation?
I would just tell you there's a lot of quality candidates. Most of the names that have been kicked around right now, Deputy Secretary Ashton Carter, who just left office a little while back, Ms. Michelle Flournoy, who I understand is not interested in the job. Those are some of the names that have been mentioned. That's the type of quality people. And I will tell you the key thing, and I think the president's taking his time on this, he wants to get a bipartisan candidate. It cannot be a party hack. And he did a good job with that, with picking Secretary Hagel. You might remember he also kept Secretary Gates over from the Bush administration. So I think the president has shown a strong recognition that the defense of the United States is not a partisan matter, nor should it be.
But let's also go one step further. If he finds somebody who is that partisan hack, but even they might be the best person for the job, he can't dither here, can he? I mean, we're at war. We can't have a vacuum there. The enemy loves a vacuum.
Yeah, somebody's going to have to be named here pretty quick. Now, Secretary Hagel's still on the job. It's not like he packed up his desk and went home yesterday. But clearly, we want to get the new person in there, especially if this new person is going to somehow change our policy or strategy.
We would only hope, some people would only hope that they do see a strategy. That, of course, is the next conversation that we'll hold for another time. But you, of course, have pointed out that we do have at least something there. Want to point out to everybody again that the book is called Why We Lost, A General's Inside Account of the Iraq and the Afghanistan Wars. Lieutenant General Daniel Bulger is the author, a fascinating book and a must read as well. Lieutenant General, thank you so much. A very happy Thanksgiving and a holiday weekend to you and your family.
Yeah, happy Thanksgiving and happy Thanksgiving to our troops around the world.
Well put indeed. Thank you so much, sir. Break and we're back with the cadre of mistakes being made by certain politicians. All of America would be thankful they corrected before putting their foot in their mouth again. It's coming up on Midpoint.